will prepare your hearts and your minds to worship the living God who has encountered us, named us, and claimed us, and embraced us in Jesus Christ. The call to worship from Psalm 34, verse 8. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who trusts in Him. Friends, let us worship God. Father, whose Son Jesus Christ taught us to pray, let our prayers for others be the kind you want and not just ways of getting what we want, who already have so much in Jesus Christ, our Savior. And so we pray for the world. Lord of all the worlds that are, Savior of all people, we pray for the whole creation. Order the unruly powers, deal with injustice, feed and satisfy the longing peoples, so that in freedom your children may enjoy the world you have made and cheerfully sing your praises. Let us pray for the church. O gracious God, you call us to be the church of Jesus Christ. Keep us one in faith and service, breaking bread together and telling good news to the world, that men and women may believe that you are love and live to give you glory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Eternal God, send peace on earth and put down greed, pride, and anger, which turn person against person and set nation against nation. Speed that day when wars will end and all human beings call you Father. And so we pray even for our enemies. Living God, whom we cannot love unless we love our brothers and sisters, remove hate from us and all people so that your children may be reconciled with those they fear or resent or threaten and live together in your peace. And so we pray for those who govern us. Almighty God, ruler of all people, direct those who make, administer, and judge our laws, President Biden, Governor DeWine, and others in authority among us, that led by your wisdom they may lead us in the way of righteousness. And so we pray as well for the work that we individually do. Manage us, wise God, by your Spirit, so the work we do may serve your good purposes and make this world a fit home for all your children. And so we pray also for the sinner. Merciful God, we confess that you bear the hurt of the world. And so look with compassion on those who are sick or suffering or struggling in any way, especially William and Levi, Dottie and Howard, Fern, and all those impacted by and suffering through the shooting incident in Indianapolis. And for that person, that circumstance nearest our heart, we now in sacred silence pray. God, for all those for whom we have prayed, cheer them by your word, bring wholeness, bring health, as a sign that in your promised kingdom there will be no more pain or crying. And so we pray for those who sorrow. God of comfort, stand with those who sorrow, that they may be sure that neither death nor life nor things present nor things to come shall separate them from your love through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so finally we pray for our friends and our families. God of our fathers and mothers, we praise you for all your servants who, having been faithful to you on earth, now live with you in heaven. Keep us in fellowship with them until we meet with all your children in the joy of the kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught his disciples to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This morning's scripture lesson comes from Acts in the New Testament, Acts chapter 5, verses 12 through 16. And so if you will, listen for what the Spirit might say to the church. Listen for God's word to you. Now many signs and wonders were done among the people through the apostles. And they were all together in Solomon's portico. None of the rest dared to join them, but the people held them in high esteem. Yet more than ever, believers were added to the Lord, great numbers of both men and women, so that they even carried out the sick into the streets and laid them on cots and mats, in order that Peter's shadow might fall on some of them as he came by. A great number of people would also gather from the towns around Jerusalem, bringing the sick and those tormented by unclean spirits, and they were all cured. Friends, this is God's word for God's people. Thanks be to God.
Oh,
history of the early church of the first days, of the primitive church and the work of the apostles. In the reading, the lesson this morning started with that singular turn of phrase, "Now many signs and wonders were done among the people." Methodist minister Johnny Matheson observes the biggest difference between Jesus' days and ours is that Jesus did signs and wonders, but then told his disciples not to advertise them. We advertise all over the place, but aren't seeing many signs and wonders done. After the resurrection and ascension of Christ, and following the day of Pentecost, and the gift of the Holy Spirit to God's people, the apostles launched into their various ministries as they each carried on the message and work of Jesus. And their message, we see it written throughout the book of Acts and the rest of the New Testament, their message pointed to Jesus Christ as God's salvation, and signs and wonders accompanied their work as a kind of seal of approval and attestation of the truth and veracity of the gospel they preached. In Peter's sermon on Pentecost, he explained why miraculous signs accompanied Jesus' ministry. In Acts chapter 2, we read, "You that are Israelites, listen to what I have to say to you. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know." The signs that accompanied Jesus, the healings, the miracles, pointed to who he was, to his identity. It was, again, a kind of attestation about who Jesus was and what he was up to. In the New Testament epistle of Hebrews, that idea is echoed in relation to both Jesus and to the apostles, that signs and wonders, that these events would accompany the work of the apostles. Is related again. Hebrews in chapter 2, verse 4 reads, "While God added to his testimony by signs and wonders and various miracles, speaking of Jesus, and by gifts of the Holy Spirit, distributed according to his will." What the writer of Hebrews is getting at there is that, again, signs and wonders, miraculous deeds accompanied both Jesus and his apostles. That's the sort of the classical Protestant understanding, that the age of miracles closed out with the closing of the New Testament canon, the completion of the writings of the New Testament. And as the 12 apostles passed off of the stage of world history one by one, Paul seemed to indicate in his letter to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 13, just that kind of idea of the tongues and prophecy, that those sort of signs would cease when that which is perfect would come. The gospel message would be codified and written and would no longer require attestation by signs and wonders. We would have the gospel in the New Testament. Yet the example of Jesus and the example of the apostles, of the signs and wonders that accompanied them in their work, suggests to us that we might have a share in that sort of work. Jesus told his disciples in John chapter 14, "Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I'm going to the Father." We have been, while the age of miracles, of signs and wonders, may have closed out with the arrival of the New Testament, we're still called to do the works of Jesus Christ. We, in our own way, are charged to live lives accompanied by signs and wonders. We are charged by Jesus to expand and enlarge his impact upon the world. The influence of Jesus and his gospel has been felt, I would submit to you, around the world and in every culture. You can witness the expanded and expansive human rights over the last 2,000 years, the establishment of innumerable colleges and universities around the world and all sorts of nations that contribute to the betterment of humanity. They're rooted and founded in Christian faith and conviction. The attainments in philosophy, the birth of modern science, art and music and literature and architecture of Western civilization, missionary and endeavors over the last 200 years which transform cultures and uplifted humanity are all attributable to the gospel of Jesus Christ and the labors of his disciples. Greater works than these, they did. Signs and wonders accompanied the works of Christians over the last 2,000 years. We can be persuaded that God even now is at work in the world and in our lives. Emerson, the sage of Concord, I think, in his address to the Harvard Divinity School, said, "Teach that God is, not was, that he speaketh, not spake." Pope Gregory the Great wrote, "All men wondered to see the water turn into wine. Every day the earth's moisture being drawn into the root of the vine is turned by the grape into wine, and no man wonders. Full of wonder, then, are all the things which men never think to wonder of." So I simply submit to you the question, how can our lives today be accompanied by signs and wonders? What acts and events and trends of and for the good can we support or enact, do? When you're hungry and receive a meal, when you're cold and are handed a blanket, when you lack housing and are housed, those are miracles. When a medical diagnosis looks bleak but a treatment is at hand that didn't exist a century ago or a decade ago or a year ago, that is a miracle, I think. When a person is rejected and pushed aside, but then is in turn embraced in the name of God's love and drawn back into relationship, a wonder occurs. So I would think that maybe we ought not be too stingy with our designation of what constitutes a sign or a wonder or a deed of power. So I would end this brief reflection on today's scripture passage simply with that question. Do we have eyes open and ears unstopped to see and hear a world full of signs and wonders of God at work in and through human lives, at work even in our own? Amen. Friends, let us pray. Living God, open to us the wonder of this world and signs of love and grace that you place all around us. May we find for ourselves opportunities to share the miracle of your love and grace with others in ways that are big and small. Amen. Support the weak and help the suffering. Honor all people, love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Friends, go in God's peace, and may God's peace and love and mercy and grace be with you and abide upon you now and forevermore and evermore. Amen.